started. I'm sure a couple people will trickle in. Thank you guys so much for coming out tonight. I know you probably have a super busy class schedule. It's 7 o'clock, prime study time. So thank you for coming, and thank you to the panelists for taking time out of your busy lives to come chat. So I see some familiar faces, which is great, and I just want to introduce myself and then introduce the panel. My name is Katie Collins, and I manage the Peace Corps recruiting office here on campus. So just a couple things to point out before we officially get started. So on your chair, you've got a couple points. This, if you just want to fill out, tell us how you heard about the event so we can help better advertise on campus. I also want to point out, we have a recruiting office here on campus. We have hours every day of the week. Ben and I run the office, and we're both grad students, return volunteers. So we're here for you guys to answer any questions you have about service, and our panelists here can obviously do that as well tonight. But we also have a really awesome mentoring program, and I'm sure some of you have heard about it, but if you haven't, on the green sheet, check it out, and then there's an email at the bottom. If you're interested in getting connected with a return volunteer in the Ann Arbor area, we are super happy to connect you with someone. Maybe you are wondering what it's like to be a female in Africa, or you want to know what it's like to be an environmental volunteer in Costa Rica or something like that. We have a lot of return volunteers who are super eager to chat with you guys, and it's a pretty cool mentoring program, so definitely check this out. And then for your own entertainment, we have some speaker bios there. So I kind of just want to jump right in, and tonight's info session is about Peace Corps and your global career. So we have some awesome panelists here. Some are in grad school, some are mid-career, some have had a really long, really exciting career, and they're here to share that with you. And we're here to answer any questions you have, so raise your hand or just shout out a question. We'll have lots of time at the end as well, but this is definitely, we want to make this interactive. We want to get you the information that you're interested in, so don't hesitate to ask any questions. So yeah, I just want to jump right into the panel. We're going to do a little panel icebreaker. So if I could just ask my panelists to introduce yourselves, what country did you serve in, and what's the weirdest thing you ate during your Peace Corps service?
I'm Jamisa McKenzie, and I served in Costa Rica from 2009 to 2012. And the weirdest thing I ate was sopa de mondongo, which is intestines.
It's delicious.
No. Would not eat again.
Like Katie said, my name is Benjamin. I'm here also working in the Peace Corps office. And I served in Ethiopia from 2011 to 2013, and the weirdest thing I ate was sheep intestine after helping slaughter it.
My name is Mary Abraham. I'm a returned Peace Corps volunteer from Ethiopia as well. I served the same time as Ben, 2011-2013, and I ate a lot of really weird stuff. Sheep intestines was one of them. Some weird butter goop. Also, I actually don't remember any of the names because I just didn't know.
Yeah. Hi everyone, I'm Chris Crestman. I was a volunteer in the Philippines from 2004 to 2006. And I would say probably the weirdest thing was probably fish eyes after we had done eating the fish.
Harvey Summers, Thailand, 1967 to 70. Ants. Regular worker ants are okay. They're sort of crunchy, queen ants, extremely bitter. But you won't run into ants a lot. Durian is the other thing to watch out for. It's a fruit that has a flesh inside, this thorny outside with a seed, and the flesh is creamy and custard-like, and they say delicious, but the smell is extraordinarily bad. It's an interesting combination.
And I served in Ukraine from 2010 to 2012. Meat jelly, super popular in Eastern Europe, not my favorite thing that I ever ate, but I swear you also encounter really delicious food, so it's not all weird things that you eat. So thanks guys for introducing yourselves. All the panelists have prompts in front of them, and they're each gonna kind of give a short presentation, so I just kind of want to go over the questions that we're gonna have them ask or answer. And then afterwards, and of course, if you have questions for them during that, that's totally fine. And then at the end, if you guys have questions, ask away. I've got some questions for them too, so we'll do a fun Q&A. So I wanted them to share with you, when did they first hear about Peace Corps and maybe what inspired them to join Peace Corps? And then what was their assignment area, what kind of projects they worked on? And then since this is all about global careers, kind of what is their career path, if they know or if they don't know, I'm still sometimes figuring that out. And then how Peace Corps kind of shaped that or inspired that. And then the last one would be kind of advice for you guys who are considering Peace Corps. Maybe some of you are even applying. So we're going to kind of go down the line, and each one's going to answer those questions. But again, please feel free if you have questions to interject. We want to make this fun and interactive. Do you want to start, Shemisa?
Yeah, great. When did I first hear about Peace Corps? I remember a friend wanting to serve, my best friend actually, from undergrad, wanted to serve in the Peace Corps when we were both in undergrad together. And I was like, 2 years? That is way too long. That is a huge time commitment. I cannot imagine leaving for 2 years. And after I graduated from undergrad, I moved out to Oregon and I worked for a few years up there. And 2 years passed so quickly. And I was like, 2 years is nothing. I can totally handle the Peace Corps. And I had always wanted to live abroad and learn a new language and interact with a new culture. And so that inspired me to join. My assignment, I was a children, youth, and families volunteer in Costa Rica. And my main projects were women's empowerment and girls' empowerment. So I led a lot of girls' groups. I started a women's group and we got a grant and built a greenhouse, and that was kind of like a source of income for them, as well as just a fun time to hang out and chat with each other and get out of the house. The women felt very homebound. A group of women asked me to start an exercise group because I used to like to run and do exercise in the community. And so I had never taught exercise, and that was a little intimidating, and I didn't think anyone would actually show up because most, like, no one exercised in Costa Rica. So I told this woman if anyone showed up, if she could get a group and come together into this like community room, which was just like a big cement block building, that I would teach. And so she got like 20 women to show up. So I had to learn how to teach exercise class. And we had a lot of fun and built weights out of cement with paint cans and other cans and bars. And did lots of other projects along the way, kids groups and camps, and built a playground and stuff. my career path, I'm working on it. I graduate in a few months from a master's in social work and a master's in public health here at U of M. And Peace Corps very much inspired the public health side. I always knew I wanted to go into social work and work individually with people. And wanted more of the individual focus. I'm going into psychotherapy with adults. But Peace Corps and being in Costa Rica, I just learned how much more our community and the social systems that we're a part of influence our mental health and our physical health and well-being, and was inspired to have more of a population level focus. And so chose a career in public health as well. And we'll see what happens when I graduate in a few months, but I hope to continue on the path of psychotherapy and public health. And advice for those considering Peace Corps. There's lots of things, I'm sure. But I think the biggest thing for me is Peace Corps is incredible, absolutely life-changing. It wouldn't change my decision to go at all, but it's really challenging. And you will be very lonely at many points in your service, and you'll question, why did I come and do this? And what, I'm like, am I having an impact? Am I making a difference? Do I want to be here? And knowing that you can answer that question before you go, and you can never fully know, but really taking into consideration, how do I take care of myself when things are really hard? And I don't have the supports that I have here to lean on. And so, that would be important consideration.
So when did I first hear about Peace Corps? So I actually, it was during undergrad, and I think I was a freshman at Colorado State University, and one of the recruiters came into our classroom to give a presentation, and I remember looking at her saying, wow, there's no way I would ever do that. That's way too long. This is just absurd. And I kind of wrote it off until that. Clearly that seed was planted a little bit. And then I've been traveling internationally since I was really young. So it's always kind of been instilled in me wanting to go and serve abroad in some capacity or another. So I studied abroad in Australia, and then I had a couple other international experiences. And when I was looking for an internship at a study abroad fair, I stumbled across the Peace Corps recruiter there, and after kind of talking to him, I remember walking out of that career fair going, yep, that's exactly what I'm going to do, I'm going to apply to the Peace Corps, and I applied right away, and that, you know, I never looked back after that. I was an environment volunteer in Ethiopia, and I worked with kind of a lot of different projects, but kind of four main projects. So a lot of it was food security related. So I did an orchard establishment project where we provided over 20,000 fruit trees and trained a lot of the local farmers how to properly plant and maintain them. And then I worked on an ecotourism development project with a non-governmental organization there. And we did a lot of training with the local tour guide association. We set up a cooperative of farmers and hired a couple staff members and really built up the website and the marketing side of it, and worked specifically with the clergy. There was a lot of ancient churches in the area, and that was kind of a main attraction, so we worked very closely with them and community members to try to get tourism in there in a more sustainable manner. And then I did an educational music video project, which was completely different than what my actual objectives and goals were for my environment program. So this was 10 songs, and it was kind of all over the place: HIV and AIDS, tuberculosis, but then education, school pride, gender equality, people living with disabilities, kind of like a wide array of topics. And we did an education, kind of a teacher's guide, trained a bunch of teachers and distributed to a lot of schools. Actually ended up presenting that project at the US Embassy with my counterpart, and his English wasn't very good when I first met him, and then over the 2 years he was able to then present at the US Embassy in front of kind of the top people for USAID and these different groups and different entities over there. So that was kind of a huge step forward for him, and that project has actually just been taken over by another Peace Corps volunteer that's currently there, so it's still going, which is awesome. And then one of my final projects was a running project, and it was 175 miles in 8 days, which was absolutely crazy. And we did HIV and AIDS education and stopped off in 8 different villages on the way down. And then we also raised over $5,000 for an NGO working on equal opportunity education in Ethiopia. So that was kind of the projects that I worked on. As far as my career path, so I am a current graduate student at School of Natural Resource Environment, and kind of my experience undergrad, I had a, you know, kind of an ecotourism focus, and I have a lot of experience there, especially in Ethiopia now. So that is still my experience and kind of like where I see my career going in ecotourism development internationally. And definitely that played a huge role in why I came to the University of Michigan and to the School of Natural Resource Environment. Because it's an amazing program that they have there, and that's, Peace Corps has basically kind of led me to grad school. I always knew I wanted to do it, and it definitely made me a really competitive candidate for grad school. And then last, just any advice that I have, I would say, you know, while Peace Corps definitely has its highs and its lows, I would say, you know, having a really positive attitude and laughing a lot and knowing that it's okay to laugh at yourself and, you know, not taking everything so seriously to where you completely burn out. And just trying to remember, you know, that like these things that happen in everyday life are hilarious in a lot of ways, and if we just kind of laugh things off, it's much easier to adapt and kind of move on. Yeah.
What was the uniqueness of the song project that it got to the UN, or why did they want to know more about it or see?
Yeah, so I had a really good relationship with the Peace Corps office during my service. I served on a committee, so I was really involved with them. And then this project specifically got funding kind of through USAID. And because of that, I kind of thought, you know, this is a great project. It's universal. You know, everybody understands music. It's something that Ethiopia definitely understands. It's a huge part of their culture. So we wanted to do the project in Tigrinya, was the local language up in my area. And then kind of the plan was we wanted to expand it to all of Ethiopia and Amharic. And that was kind of like the end goal, originally talking to my counterpart about that. And he actually started the project 2 years before I even got there. So it was already kind of going, but he hit a lot of roadblocks because of funding issues and other cultural issues. So kind of once I got involved and Peace Corps got involved, it gained all this momentum. And, you know, we were of the idea of like, let's shoot for the stars, let's just go for it. So we wanted to go as high as we could with it. And, you know, I worked really closely with the country director of Peace Corps to then get a meeting at the U.S. Embassy. And he also kind of like helped me saying, you know, like, this is a great project. So if you kind of, you can establish it and you can do it up to, you know, a certain level, then we'd love to have you come speak. And it kind of organically evolved that way. So great opportunity.
When did you first hear about the Peace Corps and what inspired you to join? I heard about the Peace Corps when I was really, really young. I believe it was from my mom. And I saw a commercial on TV that said you can donate to this Christian fund and help these, you know, starving kids overseas and things like that. And it showed a child presumably from Africa and that you could help and donate. And I explained to my mom, well, we should do that. She goes, well, you should just donate your time. Little did she know, 15 years later, I was actually going to do it. She was not thrilled. So that actually inspired me to join because I just always had in my head, like, I'm going to do this. Like, I'm going to help these people. That one little kid, I don't even remember where they were from, but that was what I was going to do. So it just continued throughout my life of, well, when I'm old enough and I have an education and I still want to do this, I'm going to do this. My assignment. I was in Ethiopia. I was a health volunteer. And I was to work with the local health department. So everyone, you kind of go in with these big plans and you think, oh, like, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do this and we're going to have all this funding. And it wasn't that extreme. I went in, noticed they weren't taking vital signs. Okay, let's work on basics. So, you know, we're going to take vital signs on everybody. Well, they didn't know how to take vital signs. So I explained how we take vital signs. I explained how to interpret vital signs. I explained what we should do. And so that was like my main project, is just basically starting at like ground level and then working the way up. So we are just doing very basic things that we consider here in the States, but over there is actually pretty advanced. Other side project, I taught English, which I loved. I wrote 3 Ethiopian children's books, and I had an HIV club that basically did awareness, and we talked about a lot of myths that were common. And I also had started a summer camp in our region, Tigray, and it was a health camp, but we also had a lot of education and environmental aspects to it as well. What's your career path? I was a little bit different. I had finished grad school before going to Peace Corps, so I went from undergrad and kind of did an application for Peace Corps and grad school, and then I actually got into grad school, so I was like, I'm going to do grad school first. So then I kind of put Peace Corps off, and then after getting out of grad school and still working, I was like, still kind of want to do that. Still want to help overseas. So I'd applied and actually went to Peace Corps following grad school. How's it shaped or inspired that? Coming back from Peace Corps, my job is pretty similar to what it was, but I'm much more resourceful. And I work at the Detroit Medical Center, so you often have to be resourceful down there. So it definitely helped me with that. Advice for people considering Peace Corps service. I would say that you should apply. If you want to do it, you need to apply, because I just knew that if I didn't, I would be really upset and I would regret it. I knew that if I went over there and I came home, then I knew that I wouldn't be upset. But I think that I knew I would be very upset if I didn't at least try. So I would say you should not apply.
Question?
Yes?
How did you approach changing people's minds about the myths of HIV or other things like that?
I found, at least where I served, that religion was a big part. So if we could get the priests on board, or if we could get, you know, whatever the main religion is there on board, and you could present the research and talk with them and say, listen, a lot of people are dying, and we're saying that this is curing them, you know, but it's not, what should we be doing? So we can kind of get people on board with, usually, at least in Ethiopia, with religion. Religious leaders. And I also think that some of the things that they were doing were not necessarily harmful, but they weren't helpful. So just say, continue those things. So if they wanted to have holy water to cure AIDS, that's great. I'll take it with your medicine. So if you take it with your antiretroviral therapy, then the holy water is not going to hurt you. So the idea was not to stop what they were doing, to understand why they were doing it, and then to kind of bring in like the what we know from a research standpoint and kind of like push those.
I think the first time I heard about Peace Corps was I worked at the study abroad office at my undergrad university, and the study abroad office was right next door to the Peace Corps office, so it was kind of nice whenever we would do events, or whenever we would do info sessions, usually we were there and then also Peace Corps was there. And so I just started kind of getting more information and just started kind of learning more about it through my position of being a peer advisor for study abroad students. And I think what ended up happening was is that both my wife and I served with my wife in the Philippines, and we both worked at the study abroad office, and we both had this kind of interest of not only a call to service, but also just an interest to kind of see the world and kind of go out there and have an adventure, which Peace Corps definitely is. If you talk to any RPCVs, and I'll tell you, it's definitely an adventure. And I think that's really what happened is that we really kind of wanted to go out there and kind of experience how a lot of other people live in the world. So we kind of want to have that kind of appreciation of, you know, we come from an amazing country, but we wanted to go out and experience something else and kind of come back. So it kind of happened where really involved in undergrad of kind of learning about the process, and then went and worked for a few years, and then decided that we really kind of wanted to serve together. We really kind of want to move forward with it. So that was kind of the process. I was a business development volunteer working in a small fishing village in the South China Sea, the most westerly island of the Philippines called Palawan. And it was, I think the other thing that a lot of RPCVs will tell you is that you might have a primary assignment, but you also have a lot of secondary projects, and they're projects that kind of take hold of your service because, you know, you're there. I was there to advise on a women's group on their handicraft projects. So we were working on marketing plans, we were looking at avenues that they could sell it to. But the NGO that I worked with did a lot with family planning, environmental education, coastal resource management. And then I ended up getting involved with a lot of agriculture. Worked with local farmers, because what we were finding is that with my counterpart and I, we were finding that a lot of farmers were coming in and just selling their products to a middleman. And what we started to do was to kind of talk with them to say, you know, if you all came together on the same day, you guys could have your own farmer's market. And it was a novel idea for them to kind of come in to kind of be like, okay, so they're the ones that are selling their produce rather than just selling it to someone and then going back to their farm. And I think the one kind of theme that you go in with services that you want to make it sustainably, but I want to so that when you leave it continues. And it was really nice because throughout service that was one thing that I just really kind of want to make an impact, but I wanted to be sustainable without me having to be there. And it was really nice because at the beginning, you know, we would only have two or three farmers that would show up to the basketball court in town, and you know, they all knew us very well, the nonprofit that I worked for. And then it was nice for the 2 years of service that by the end it had grown to a bi-weekly market, and there were, you know, 20 to 25 producers that would come in on a regular basis, and it was to the point where they didn't know who I was. And that's what I saw as a goal. I saw that as, you know, it wasn't that this person came in and then they started this project and now we can't continue it. It was all mobilized through them because they came in and they were the ones to kind of control it. They're the ones that proposed going to twice a week to come in. And it was just one of those things where I would walk around the market and, you know, get our produce, and the people that I was, you know, buying had no idea who I was, and I loved that. That was something that I kind of would walk away with a smile on my face and kind of be like, yeah, that was a really great project. And along with Chamisa kind of talking about, I was a lifeguard in high school, and we did this coastal resource management project where we were going out and setting up artificial reefs. And surprisingly, you know, Filipinos that in our village live right on the ocean, but every one of them didn't know how to swim. And it was one of those things where, you know, you take that for granted, and they would go out in the water, but they would only go up to their knees. And my supervisor was like, oh, you taught swimming? Why don't you teach us swimming? So it was really great. We would go down to the bay, and it was like, all right, well, let's work on freestyle. And, you know, it was just one of those things where we kind of went out there and we worked on, you know, freestyle and breaststroke and all these kind of different things. And it was great because everybody was just having fun and smiling. And those are the kind of things that, you know, it wasn't a major thing that I worked on, but it was definitely an impact that I think it was a really nice project. Career path. It's interesting because I think what happened was is that Peace Corps kind of took hold of me, and that it will always kind of be part of me. Once we got done with our service, I really kind of wanted to, we came close to extending for a third year, but I had a mentor that was part of the U.S. Direct Hire staff that was based in Manila that I would go into and talk with, and he kind of said, well, you could kind of be one of us. And he said, well, definitely get in line, because there's a lot of people that want to go out to be staff. And it was nice because I made that kind of my goal. So after serving and traveling, my wife and I, we moved to D.C., and I got a job in Peace Corps headquarters. And so I started out in what's called a staging unit, which is an orientation. So whenever a group goes overseas, they go through a short orientation. It's definitely now much shorter than it was before. Before it was a 2 to 3 day training model, but now it's shortened to a 1 day model. But I've worked as a trainer for that, and then worked in the budget office, because my idea is that I wanted to get back out to be what was called a director of management operations. So kind of overseeing contracting, budgeting, all the behind the scenes of running a Peace Corps operation at whatever post it was. And so I was always trying to get skills that we're working on managing, budgeting, those skills that could make me a candidate to go out there. So I was at Peace Corps headquarters for about a little over 3 years, and then most recently just returned 6 months ago from the Republic of Georgia as the Director of Management Operations. So I was there, and it was a very great experience. That was one of those things where Peace Corps, as a staff member, it was set up so that it has term limits. It's one of the only federal agencies that has that. So the absolute maximum that you can work for Peace Corps as a staff is 8.5 years, and I was at 7.5 years. And the idea was to kind of come back. It was a great experience, but it was also an idea that if I cut it short a little bit, then I can kind of go back out and be a staff member again, because it's something that I definitely want to do again. And it really inspired, because I think even now what I do here is I work for the School of Natural Resources and Environment, and I split my time between the Office of Academic Programming and the Dean's Office. And one of those initiatives that I work on is recruiting return Peace Corps volunteers to the school, working on international initiatives. And it's great, as you may or may not know, with the University of Michigan, there's a lot of programs that are here, and there's a lot of collaboration that can happen across the board, because Michigan, as you know, the founding place for when Senator Kennedy was here, making that speech in 1960 to now, it's definitely has a rich history, and it's nice to kind of build off of that. So I'm here now for 3 months working for the university on a lot of different initiatives, but one of those is recruiting more RPCVs to choose SNRE as their school choice. Advice, definitely, I can echo a lot of things that have said before me, but also I think it really helps to kind of go in with no expectations. That's one thing that I would always tell new groups of volunteers, trainees that would come in, is that you kind of come in with no expectations. It really helps, because I think a lot of people, like Mary was saying, that you kind of want to come in and change the world. And you're definitely making an impact, but it's one of those things where I think if you go in and not setting the bar low, but going in with the idea that even making incremental changes is a really large step forward. And it also helps to be flexible, because you know, you could get there and your one project that you were really excited about working on throughout your pre-service training could kind of fall apart, and it's kind of being flexible to kind of see what resources are there at your site to kind of piece together a project that is exciting to you and your counterpart.
So that's the 21st century there. Now, for the 20th century, I was in high school when President Kennedy was assassinated. I went to Ohio University, that's not Columbus now, that's Athens, at a time when Ohio University wasn't a really impressive place. Teachers, professors that were really inspiring were rare. John Cady was the one who stood out. He was a professor of Southeast Asian history. A Peace Corps recruiter came to town, and I said, Peace Corps, do you have any programs in Southeast Asia? And the answer was Thailand. I went to Thailand. It was good. It was a little bit of a fight. It was good to get there. That was a time, the 1960s, when there were a lot of people looking at Peace Corps and a lot of people enthused about Peace Corps. That was part of that. I enjoyed that. Primary projects, secondary projects, taught English. That's all I did. In Thailand in 1967, I was assigned to a boys' high school for my first year, and after the high school, evening classes for adults and others who wanted to learn English. Second year, I actually moved to a regional center and helped supervise elementary schools in five provinces, and so saw elementary students studying English. Remember getting up at 4 a.m., taking the boat across the lake, getting on a motorcycle, riding on